Question number one. What characterizes an object's motion as simple harmonic? So the keyword for simple harmonic motion is a restoring force. And there must be a restoring force acting on the object in the opposite direction of the motion. Then this object makes simple harmonic motion. Question number two. Does the acceleration of a simple harmonic oscillator remain constant during its motion? Is acceleration even zero? Acceleration of a simple harmonic oscillator remain constant is not correct, because acceleration changes as the object is moving. So now, in simple harmonic motion, remember, object is moving between two extreme points, plus A and minus A. So right here is the equilibrium position. So as the object is moving away from the equilibrium position towards the positive A, its acceleration increases. And acceleration right here becomes maximum. At maximum, displacement becomes maximum. Then object turns back, starts to approach to the equilibrium position. As the object is approaching the equilibrium position, this time acceleration decreases. And finally, at equilibrium position, it becomes zero. Why is it zero at equilibrium position? Remember, acceleration is equal to force divided by mass. So in simple harmonic motion, F is proportional to the displacement. For example, remember with mass spring system, it is minus k times x. So if x is equal to zero, which means when the object is at equilibrium position, x is equal to zero, force is equal to zero, it is zero. So if it's zero, then acceleration becomes again zero. So what is the type of the energy of a pendulum bob when it is released? How does the energy of the bob change as it swings through the one full cycle of motion? As it's a pendulum, this is the equilibrium position of the pendulum. Initially, we should pull the pendulum by an angle of theta, which is the amplitude in simple pendulum. Then we should release it. Right here, when we release it, it starts to swing like that. As you see, initially, it is in a height h. At this h, it has a gravitational potential energy. It's a kind of potential energy, but gravitational, which is equal to mgh. Yeah, and before just it is released, the pendulum bob will have the gravitational potential energy. How does the energy of bob change as it swings? As it swings towards the equilibrium position, gravitational potential energy decreases because altitude decreases. Final altitude becomes zero. That's why this gravitational potential energy must be converted to other types of energy according to conservation of mechanical energy. So right here, it passes with greatest speed. For that, as an equilibrium position, the gravitational potential energy is zero. Kinetic energy becomes maximum. And the last question is, an ideal mass spring system vibrating with simple harmonic motion would oscillate indefinitely. Because it's ideal, ideal system does not lose energy. If it doesn't lose energy, it will continually oscillate between the same points. So between plus A and minus A. Because remember, energy is proportional to amplitude. If energy is constant, remember, square of the amplitude. If energy is constant, then amplitude must stay the same. Then object must continuously oscillate between these two points. In which cases amplitude decreases? If it is not ideal. If it's a real system, system starts to lose the energy. If energy is lost, the system starts oscillating with smaller amplitude by time. Finally, it will stop. So it is called, remember, damped harmonic motion. Question number five. In a simple pendulum, the weight of the bob can be divided into two components. One component is the bob's direction, one tangent to the bob's direction of motion, and the other perpendicular to bob's direction of motion. Which of these is the restoring force and why? So remember, if we draw a simple pendulum, this is the equilibrium position. You should pull the simple pendulum away from the equilibrium position by an angle, theta. Remember, this angle must be smaller than 15 degrees. So in this case, pendulum's motion is a simple harmonic motion. So on the pendulum's bob, there are two forces acting. One of them is Fg. The other one is Ft. So Fg has two components. One component of Fg is perpendicular to the direction of the motion, Fgy. Other component is parallel to direction of the motion, Fgx. Remember, in simple harmonic motion, there must be restoring force, and this restoring force must be always parallel to the direction, the path. So direction of the motion of the path is this. So the component which is parallel to this direction will be the restoring force. So FGX is the component which is parallel to the direction of the motion. For that reason, FGX, and which is the tangent to the Bob's direction, is the restoring force. So mg times sine theta is the restoring force for a simple pendulum. Next one, question number 6. What is the total distance traveled by an object moving back and forth in simple harmonic motion in a time interval equal to its period when its amplitude is a? Remember, in a period of time, object starts from a, goes to negative a, comes again to positive a. So it is the time for one period. So because it's asking about the distance, this is a scalar quantity, so you should add the distances. Now, from positive a to 0, which is the equilibrium position, distance traveled is a. Then from 0 to negative a, again distance traveled is a plus a to a. One more a from negative a to o, 3a. One more a from o to plus a, 4a. So you are going to add them and make that you will find the distance as 4a. Question number 7. What happens to the period of a simple pendulum when the pendulum's length is doubled? What happens when the mass is doubled? So equation for period of simple pendulum is this. T is equal to 2 pi the root of L over AG. When you double the length, so period is increased by a factor of root 2 because here is the square root. However, mass has no effect on the pendulum because in the equation of the period, you are not going to see anything related to mass. So for that reason, period is independent of mass of the bob. Question number 8. It says that a pendulum's bob is made with a ball filled with water. So filled with water. And mass of the pendulum is almost the mass of the water. What would happen to the frequency of the vibration of this pendulum if a hole in the ball allow water to leak out? So if the water is leaking out, mass decreases. So only thing is we should think is this mass decreases. In decreasing mass has no effect on the period or frequency of the pendulum, because pendulum's equation for period is this. T is equal to 2 pi L over AG. So as you see in your equation, there is no mass. So period or frequency of the pendulum, simple pendulum, is independent of mass. If the water leaks out, mass decreases, but it has no effect on the pendulum's period. Next question. If a pendulum clock keeps perfect time at the base of a mountain, will it keep also perfect time when moved to the top of the mountain? So what happens if you move to the top of the mountain? AG decreases. So decreasing AG, because when you go up to the sky, remember in the first chapter, last section, gravitational force section, we studied this. If the distance to the center of Earth increases, so AG decreases, gravitational acceleration decreases. Decreasing gravitational acceleration results in increase in the period of the simple pendulum, so it will not keep the perfect time because its period has changed. Next question, question number 10. If a clock is running slow, how can you adjust the length of the pendulum to correct the time? If it is running slow, which means T is big. So if T is big, you should make T smaller. How can you make the T smaller? According to the equation of the pendulum of simple period of a simple pendulum, if you want to make T smaller, to make it smaller, you should make the length smaller. Yeah, and if you decrease the length of the pendulum, you are going to make the T smaller. Smaller T means it will start moving faster. Question number 11. If a simple pendulum can be used as an altimeter. Altimeter is a device which measures the altitude of a point. Altimeter on a plane, how will the period of the pendulum change or vary as the plane rises from the ground to its cruising altitude of 10,000 meter. So as the altitude increases, you know, AG, gravitational acceleration, decreases. Pendulum will start moving slower. Next question, question number 12. Will the period of a vibrating mass spring system on the Earth be different from the period of an identical mass spring system on the Moon? Yani, you can think like this. You have just one system. You first measure its period on the Earth, and you take the same system to the Moon. You measure its period. Will there be a change? No, it will not, because when you change from Earth to Moon, AG decreases. However, mass spring system has a period equation which is equal to 2 pi mass over k. As you see in your equation, there is no AG. Yani, acceleration of gravity cannot affect the period of a mass spring system for that reason. So there will be no change in the period of the mass spring system. Now the next question, question number 13. It says, a pendulum that moves through its equilibrium position once every 1 second is called a seconds pendulum. This is a specific name. Yani, there is a pendulum. This pendulum passes from equilibrium position once to left. Of course, if it is 1 second to pass left, it goes to right 1 second too. So total time for one cycle is 2 seconds. So period of a simple pendulum is 2 seconds. So a pendulum moves through its equilibrium position twice for one complete cycle. For that, the period of the second pendulum is equal to 2 seconds. So then, question part A says, what is the period of the any seconds pendulum? It's 2 seconds. Next, in Cambridge, England, a seconds pendulum is 0.9942 meter long. What is the free fall acceleration in Cambridge? So simply, you are going to use the equation for pendulum. Length is given, period is of the second pendulum is 2, acceleration of gravity you should calculate, t is equal to 2 pi root of L over g, squared them, 2 pi squared is 4 pi squared, square root will be removed, so then ag becomes 4 pi squared L over t squared. Simply you are going to change the places and then you are going to calculate the answer as 9.8024 meter per second squared. Next question is 13. A spring with a spring constant 180 newton meter, so spring constant is given 180 newton meter, is attached to 1.5 kilogram mass. So mass of the object is 1.5 kilograms. So remember this mass spring system. What is the period of the mass spring system? You will calculate T and you will calculate the frequency of the vibration. So remember, this is a spring. So you connect a mass to a spring. Then you are going to set it in motion. So this is the equilibrium position. It will start between two extreme points, positive and negative A, to vibrate. So period equation is 2 pi m over k. Simply write it 2 pi, m is 1.3 kilogram, k is 180. So you are going to find the period as 0.57. Frequency is inversely proportional to period. F is equal to 1 over t. So f is equal to 1 over 0.57. So answer will be 1.75. Next question is question number 15. This now from now on, we will start answering the question about waves. What is common to all waves? All kinds of waves. They're asking about the core definition of the wave. First, a wave is a traveling disturbance. Second, it carries energy from one place to another. You can continue adding here because waves also can carry energy without little loss. Yani, efficiency of the energy transfer for waves is high. There's another thing you can say that. In wave motion, medium is not carried, just medium is, the particles in the medium is vibrating. So you can continue adding properties of the wave to this question. Next question, how do the transverse and longitudinal wave differ? Difference is that in transverse waves, wave moves in one direction, but vibration is always perpendicular to the direction of the motion of the wave. In longitudinal wave, direction of the vibration and direction of the motion of the wave are parallel. That is the only difference between the transverse and longitudinal waves. Question number 17. The figure below depicts a pulse wave. As you see, it's a pulse. A short duration of the wave is called a pulse. A wave traveling on a spring. In which direction are the particles of the medium vibrating? So as pulse is moving in horizontal, remember it's a transverse wave. the particles are vibrating in vertical because here is the equilibrium position. So as you see, particles are vibrating or displacing away from the equilibrium position in perpendicular to the direction of the motion. So it makes this wave as transverse wave. Next question, question number 18. In a stretch spring, several coils are pinched together and others are split farther apart than usual. What sort of wave is this? So pinched together produces a compression. So when split apart from each other, it's called a stretch. For that reason, compression and stretch only available for longitudinal waves. So this is a longitudinal wave. Question number 19, if you shook the end of a rope up and down 3 times each second, so each second 3 times, so frequency in this case is equal to 3 hertz. Number of cycles in 1 second is called frequency, so in each second 3 times up and down, which makes the frequency 3. What would be the period of the wave set up in the rope? What would be the frequency? We said that there are 3 vibrational cycles in 1 second, so frequency is equal to 3 hertz. And we know that period is equal to 1 over f, so 1 over 3, you can say that it is 0.33 second is the period of this oscillation. Next question, how does a single point on a string move as a transverse wave passes by that point? When the transverse wave passes it can be a rope or a spring, the points are vibrating up and down. Remember, so because the direction of the motion and direction of the vibration must be perpendicular to each other. What happens to the wavelength of a wave on a string when the frequency is doubled? What happens to the speed of the wave? Crucial question here. Speed of a wave only depends on the medium. So is there a change in the medium? No. Speed is always constant in this case. You can only change the speed of a wave if you change some property of the medium, but there is no change in the property of the medium, so speed is constant. If speed is constant, wavelength and frequency are inversely proportional. So if frequency is doubled, if you increase the frequency by 2, wavelength must decrease by 2, so result must be again constant. So to stay the same with that speed, increasing frequency results in decrease in the wavelength. Okay, let's go on by next question. Question number 22. It says, why do sound waves need a medium through which travel? Because sound wave is a mechanical wave, or another name, mechanical waves, and all they need material medium, which means medium which contains molecules, because sound is transferred from one place to another by the vibration of molecules. Without molecules, it is impossible to transfer the sound. Question number 23. Two tuning forks with frequencies of 256 and 512 hertz are struck. Which of the sounds will move faster through the air? So air is the medium. As I said before, without changing the property of the medium, you cannot change the speed of wave in that medium. So both sound will move with the same speed. Now, frequency has no effect on the speed, only type of the medium or property of the medium can change the speed of wave in that medium. Question number 24. What is the one advantage of the transferring energy by electromagnetic waves? So electromagnetic waves are so fast, 3 times 10 to the power of 8 meters per second is their speed. So you can easily, quickly transfer energy from one place to another, rapidly. Another one, you can add energy to electromagnetic waves as much as possible. It depends on your source. So they can also create a very large amount of energy. And very efficiently, energy loss is very small because even there is, in wave motion, there is vibration. But no transfer of medium, but in electromagnets, even particles are not vibrating. It's another kind of energy transfer method, so energy can be transferred from one point to another the most efficiently. Next question, question number 25. It says, a wave traveling in the positive extraction with a frequency of 24 hertz, so 25 hertz, this is the frequency, as shown in figure. Find the following values for this. So amplitude. Amplitude is the distance from the equilibrium position to crest or from equilibrium position to trough. As you see, this distance is 18 centimeters, so half of them is the amplitude. So 18 divided by 2, 9 centimeters is the amplitude of the wave. Wavelength is the distance from crest to crest or from trough to trough, or it is the length of a when complete wavelength, but that distance is given. If this is 10 centimeters, that's also 10 centimeters. So from crest to crest, it's the wavelength, which is equal to 10 plus 10, it becomes 20 centimeters. So wavelength of the wave is 20 centimeters. Period, frequency is given, it is 25 hertz. Remember, period is equal to 1 over f, 1 over 25, it is 0.04 second. Speed is equal to wavelength multiplied by frequency. Wavelength we calculated as 20 centimeters, which is 0.2 meter, right 0.2 here. Frequency is given, the question is 25, when you multiply them, answer become 5 meter per second. This is the speed of that wave. Question number 26 is microwaves, radio waves, travel at the speed of light. Generally, microwaves are used for cell phone communications. Speed of light is, all electromagnetic waves are traveling with speed of light, which is 3 times 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. When the frequency of the microwave is 9 times 10 to the power of 9 hertz, what is their wavelength? Simple question, just so you know, V is equal to lambda times F. Lambda is asked, V divided by F. V is given, F is given. Simply, we'll calculate the wavelength of the wave. Using this superposition principle, draw the resultant wave for each of the examples below. Now, as you see, these two waves are propagating or vibrating in the same direction. For that reason, they will support each other and result a wave which is greater in amplitude. So right here, they are in negative x direction, while displacement, they will again support each other and result a greater amplitude wave. So resultant wave will be this one. But in the second one, so they are vibrating in opposite directions. So displacement is, one of them is in positive, the other one is in negative. So they will cancel each other and result a zero displacement. Right here also zero displacement. As you see, these two waves will completely cancel each other and there will be no vibration in the string or in the medium for a short time. Now question number 28. What is the difference between constructive interference and destructive interference? Remember, in constructive interference, so the waves are propagating or vibrating in the same direction, and displacement must be in the same direction. In destructive interference, if one of them is vibrating positive, the other one must vibrate in negative direction, so then they will cancel or they will weaken each other. It's the destructive interference. Question number 29, which of the waveforms shown below is the resultant waveform? Right from here you can get it. Look at here. Y2, Y1, and Y3. As you see, Y3 is addition of Y2 and Y1. And Y3 is greater than Y1, Y3 is greater than Y2, which means Y3 is the resultant wave. So resultant waveform is Y3 here. And third one, which is the red one, or this color. Next question, question number 30. Rami sends a series of pulses of amplitude 24 centimeters down a string. Down doesn't mean the downward. Yeah, send down. Send, simply, it's a phrasal verb. Send down a string that is attached to a post at one end. Attached to a post at one end. Assume the pulses are reflected with no loss of amplitude. What is the amplitude at a point on the string where two pulses are crossing if the string is rigidly attached, yani fixed boundary? If it is fixed boundary, assume that there are pulses centered in the same direction. But because this end is fixed, this pulse will turn upside down while the second one is still moving to right. The first one will be reflected with inverted. Reflected by inverting. So then these two pulses are vibrating in opposite direction, they will cancel each other. So there will be a completely destructive interference. So amplitude will be zero. If end is free, free, then the case will be like this. So this is the initial pulse. This is part of the second pulse. This is the first pulse. So this end is free, so easily can move. Later, the first pulse will reflect, but second one still approaching. When they meet, because they are vibrating in the same direction, they will support each other and result a greater amplitude, which is 24 plus 24, 48 centimeter. Question number 31, can more than two waves interfere in a given medium? Yes, all we are talking about this. So constructive interference, if they are vibrating in the same direction, or destructive interference, if they vibrate in the opposite directions. What is the resulting amplitude of a position where destructive interference is complete? As you see, if it is completely destructive, the point will not vibrate. So resulting displacement in this case will be zero, because one of them is upward, the other one is downward, so they are equal in numbers, so amplitude will be zero. When two waves interfere, can the resultant wave be larger than either of the two original waves? If so, under what conditions? Yes, possible. If two waves are vibrating in the same direction, the resultant will be larger than the individual waves. It is only available for constructive interference. And question number 34, it says, which of the following wavelengths will produce standing waves on a string which is 3.5 meter long? Remember, in there were standing waves, first one, second, third, fourth. Each standing wave, first standing wave consists one loop. Each loop has a wavelength 0.5 lambda. So 0.5 lambda is equal to L. So we can calculate the 3.5, so it becomes 8 meters. For the second one, because there are two loops, each loop is 0.5 lambda, two, because there are two loops, so 2 times 0.5 lambda is equal to L. So then L becomes lambda 2. So lambda 2 is equal to length of the string, which is 3.5. For the third one, there are three loops. 3 times 0.5, because each loop has a wavelength 0.5, so lambda 3 is equal to L. So then one, L is equal to 1.5 lambda 3. Lambda 3 becomes L over lambda 3 becomes L is equal to 3.5 divided by 1.5, which is equal to 2.33. Fourth one has four loops, and 4 times 0.5 lambda 4 is equal to L. So L is equal to 2 lambda 4. So then lambda 4 becomes. Next question, question 37. What is the free fall acceleration in a location where the pendulum is over 0.85 meter long pendulum is 1.86? So period is 1.86. Length of the pendulum is 0.85. So you will find what the acceleration of gravity. Your equation is known. T is equal to 2 pi root of L over AG. So to calculate the AG, you should first square the equation and get rid of the square root. T squared is equal to 4 pi squared. Be careful, you are going to square not only pi, 2, but also square of 2 is 4, square of 4 pi squared. Get you by squaring the square root, you remove it. So then AG becomes 4 pi squared. Simply change their places. AG is equal to 4 pi squared, L over T squared, and write the numbers and calculate the acceleration of gravity. And question number 37, a certain pendulum clock that works perfectly on Earth is taken to the moon, where acceleration of gravity is smaller than Earth, which is 1.63 meters per second squared. If the clock is started 12 a.m., what will its read after 24 hours have passed on the Earth? So first, we know that on the Earth, delta T, 24 hours passed. So what is the time measured on the moon, delta T on the moon? We will find that. So we should first understand the ratio. We should first find the ratio between the period on the Earth and period on the moon. So 2 pi L over AG on the moon, 2 pi L over AG on the Earth, pardon, vice versa, AG on the Earth, AG on the Moon. So when you did this calculation, you will find period on the Earth is equal to root 2 times root of L, L is length of the pendulum, on the Moon 4.9 times root of L, So simply you are going to do this operation. Now compare them to find the relation or the ratio between the period on the moon and period on the earth. So when you divide them, this cancel. Period on the moon is 2.45 times greater period on the earth. What does this mean? On the moon, the pendulum is moving 2.45 times slower. Yani the clock on the moon is 2.45 times slower than clock on the earth. If it is slower, it measures time slower. Yani the clock on the moon measures time slower, smaller than earth. How many times? 3.45 times. So in earth, how many hours pass? 24 hours. So these 24 hours corresponds to how many hours on the moon? 9.8 hours. 9.8 hours and 24 hour on the earth corresponds or equals to 9.8 hour on the moon. So 9.8 hours means 9 hours plus 0.8 hours, but 0.8 hours cannot be shown on a clock. So for that, we will show this as a minute. To calculate the corresponding minute, you should multiply 0.8 hour by 60 minutes, which becomes 48 minutes. Yani, on the moon, 9 hour and 48 minutes passed. Because clock starts from 24, on the moon, the clock will show 9:48 a.m. Now, let's solve the multiple choice questions. The first question, spring, and an object is connected to spring, but we don't know where is the x equilibrium position, where is the positive amplitude, where is negative, it's not given. So in which what direction does the restraining force act? Still, we don't know it, because if it is on the left of the equilibrium position, restraining force will be to right. If it is on the right of the equilibrium position, restraining force will be to left. So according to the where the object is located, restraining force direction changes. So it is to left or to right, depending on where the spring is stretched or compressed. In what form is the energy in the system when the mass passes through the equilibrium position? When it passes from equilibrium position, always kinetic energy, no elastic potential energy, because there is no compression or stretch. Okay, next question. Question number three, it says, in what form is the energy in the system when the spring mass is at maximum displacement? Yani, maximum displacement means spring is stretched the most. Yani, it is elastic potential energy. Potential energy, and elastic because 1 over 2 kx squared. If you stretch it the most, elastic potential energy becomes maximum. Which of the following does not affect the period of mass spring system? Remember, period of mass spring system is 2 pi m over k. Mass, yes, affects. Spring constant, yes, affects. Amplitude of the vibration, no. As you see in the equation, there is no amplitude. All of the above, no. Just C is not, does not affect the period of the mass spring system. Next question, if the mass of 48 kilograms, so this is the mass, of a spring constant is k, what is the period? Simply equation, just 2 pi m over k. M is 48, k is 12, so when you multiply it, you will find result as 4 pi second. B, your answers to question 6 to 9 on the information below. This is a pendulum, simple pendulum, spoke hangs from the string and moves with a simple harmonic motion as shown above, or on the left. What is the restraining force in the pendulum? So remember, restraining force is the one component of Fg. Remember, there were two components, Fgy and Fgx, equilibrium position. Which of the following does not affect the period of the pendulum? Period of the pendulum, simple pendulum, is equal to 2 pi length of the pendulum divided by acceleration of gravity. So length affects. Mass of the bob, as you see, there is no mass in the pendulum's motion. Free fall acceleration, yes. So this mass does not affect the period of the simple pendulum because it's not included in your equation. If the pendulum completes exactly 12 cycles in 2 minutes, what is the frequency? Remember, frequency is the number of cycles divided by total time. Number of cycles is 12, total time is 2 minutes, which is equal to 120 seconds. So frequency becomes, in this case, 0.1 hertz. 9, it says if the pendulum's length is 2 meters and acceleration of gravity is 9.8 meters per second, so how many complex oscillations does the pendulum make in 5 minutes? First, you should calculate the period of the simple pendulum, which is equal to 2 pi L over Hg. 2 pi L is 2 meter, Hg is 9.8. So period of the pendulum is 2.84 seconds. Remember, period is time for one cycle. And one cycle takes 2.84 seconds. How many oscillations or cycles or vibrations in 5 minutes? 5 minutes is 5 times 60, which is 300 seconds. How many cycles are there? Cross multiplication, simply do it. X times 2.84 is equal to 5 times 60, which is 300. So X becomes, when you divide them by 2.84 and 2.84, so result becomes 106 cycles. Question number 10 to 12 on the graph, answer the question accordingly. What kind of wave does this graph represent? It's a transverse wave. It's easy because vibrations in vertical, motions in horizontal. So they are perpendicular to each other. So which letter on the graph is used for wavelength? Wavelength is the from crest to crest or from trough to trough, but C is given, so C is the wavelength of the wave. Which letter on the graph is used for a trough? Trough is the farthest point from the equilibrium position, negative direction. So this is the trough, as you see. So A is the point which represents trough. From turning, we will continue. A wave with amplitude 0.75 meter has the same wavelength as a second wave with an amplitude of 0.53 meter. When two waves interfere, what is the amplitude of the resulting wave when they interfere? When the interference is constructed, they will support each other, so resultant amplitude will be addition of the amplitude of individual waves. What is the amplitude of the resultant wave if the interference is destructive? If destructive, resultant wave's amplitude will be difference between the amplitudes, because one of them is vibrating up, the other one is vibrating down, so we are going to subtract them, and you will find the answer as 0.22 for the first one, 1.28. And last questions. It says that two successive crests of a transverse wave is 1.2 meter apart. So this is wavelength. Eight crest passes a given point in 12 seconds. So this is total time delta t. What is the average speed? First, we should calculate the frequency. Number of cycles, total time, divided by total time is the frequency. Number of cycles is 8 crest passes, which means 8 cycles, 8. Total time is 12 seconds, 8 over 12, which is equal to 2 over 3. Hertz is equal to its frequency. Remember, the speed is lambda times f. Lambda is 1.2, so simply write it. Frequency, just calculated 2 over 3. Then multiply them, you will find the answer as 0.8. Green light has a wavelength of 5.2 times 10 to the power minus 7 meter, and speed in the air is speed of light, as you see, 3 times 10 to the power 8 meter per second. We'll calculate the frequency and the period of the wave. Remember, speed of a wave, its general equation, lambda times f. F becomes speed divided by lambda. Speed of the wave or light divided by wavelength, it is the frequency of the wave. Period is equal to 1 over frequency, they are inversely related. 1 over 5.8 times 10 to the power 14, so this is the answer for the period of the wave order. What kind of the wave does not need a medium? Remember, electromagnetic waves does not need a medium. Mechanical waves need a medium. Next question. A visitor to the ancient city of Arbil wishes to find out the height of a tower. The visitor ties a spool of thread to a small rock and made a simple pendulum. Yani, this is the tower, say that. But we don't know what the tower's height. So, then the visitor hangs a pendulum down a spiral staircase in the center of the town. Now, right here, from here today, they suspended a pendulum and set the pendulum in vibration and measured the period of the vibration as 9.49. So period of the vibration is 9.81. We know that acceleration of gravity is 9.81. Calculate the length of the string. Length of the string at the same time is equal to what? The length of the tower. So then, period of the pendulum is equal to t 2 pi root of L over 2. So you should get rid of square root by squaring the equation. T squared becomes 4 pi squared L over Hg. L becomes cross multiply Hg times t squared divided by 4 pi squared. So when Hg, t, 4 and pi squared calculated, 22.4 meters is the height of the tower, which is the length of the string. Harmonic wave is traveling on a long rope. Harmonic wave is it's a kind of a periodic wave. The oscillator that generates the wave completes 40 vibrations in 30 seconds. So you can easily calculate the frequency because number of vibrations in 1 second or total vibrations or total time gives us the frequency. 40 vibrations in 30 seconds, so it is 1.33 is the frequency. A given crest of the wave travels 425 centimeters along the rope in a period of 10 seconds. This is not T, this says delta T. Be careful about this. And when it says a period of time, it is the delta T, not period of the motion. So then delta T is equal to 10 seconds. Distance traveled by the wave is 425 centimeters, so 4.25 meters. So when you divide distance by time, you will find the speed of the wave, which is 0.425 meters per second. So you know speed, you know frequency, you can calculate the wavelength because wavelength is equal to speed divided by frequency. Speed you just calculated, frequency you calculated. So